story that I want to tell you very quickly. Some 50 years ago when this building was built, I'm told it was the evening of the festival of Purim. And the men at the time, and there weren't this many, there were just a handful of men, got together for afternoon services. It was a fast day. And they asked some unsuspecting 16-year-old to get up and be the chazan for the men. And that person was Rabbi Ezra Labaton, Zecher Tzadik Dibracha, the first person ever to be a chazan in this building. I'm glad to say that his spirit resides and is alive and well here in the building. And even more so in his daughter, Dr. Sara Labaton, who we're so happy to have here. I couldn't think of a better lineup than Rabbi Tobias and Sara for tonight, and I'm thankful that everyone's here to stay. And to Sara, I want to say this. Brooklyn, Manhattan, male or female, there's always an audience here for you in the community, and here, especially in our shul, you're always welcome here, you're always encouraged to come here, and anything that you have to share with us, there'll always be someone here to listen to you. So with no further delay, please give your full attention to Sara. Make sure you have a source sheet, and thank you again for being here.
First of all, thank you so much for inviting me here tonight. It's especially moving to teach this particular material at Beit Torah, which, like Jeffrey said, was really my father's first spiritual home. I'm not a medical doctor, thank God for everybody, and I don't have a specialty in contemporary medical ethics, but what really pushed me to explore this material was the experience of watching my father go through his illness. The 15 years of functioning well, of not functioning well, of pain, of endurance, of our family's black humor, of doctors and nurses who felt like angels, and doctors who made insensitive comments and really did asinine things. If it wasn't for that experience, there's no amount of textual expertise or knowledge would really prepare me to discuss the ideas that I'd like to discuss tonight. What I'd like to do is take a Talmudic source, which at face value seems thoroughly obscure and irrelevant with our engagement with modern medicine. In fact, according to its original meaning, it probably is irrelevant to us. However, as later and later Jewish thinkers grappled with and interpreted this comment, this Talmudic comment on medicine and doctors, they turned it into something relevant for their own times. And I think that we can take it a few steps further and turn it into a revolutionary way of thinking about medicine, about healing, about illness, a way of thinking that is also starting to gain currency in the medical establishment, as far as I can tell. What I'd like to argue tonight is that although Judaism unequivocally places supreme, even transcendent value on human life, the tradition, our tradition, has a complicated and nuanced attitude to the question of whether doctors have the right, I'll say that again, whether doctors have the right to administer medical care, whether they need divine or halachic permission to do so, whether seeking medical care is ideal, or alternatively, a concession to human nature. And ultimately, what I argue is that the Jewish philosophical and halachic tradition developed a covenantal model over time on the delivery of medical care. What I mean by that is the following. Yes, we may administer medical care to those in need on the condition that we treat people who are ill with empathy, humility, and dignity. Let's start with the first two sources. So the first source, number one, is from the Torah, from Parshat Mishpatim, and it seems like a pretty straightforward narrative. When men quarrel and one strikes the other with stone or a fist, and the victim does not die, but does have to take to his bed, if he is then able to get up, in other words, he's not severely wounded, he's able to get up and walk outside with his stick, the aggressor, the assailant, will not be punished, but he has to pay shevet, which means unemployment, the loss of the victim's time, and, I'll read this in Hebrew, virapko yirapeh, and heal he shall heal. So what does that mean? What is the other thing that the assailant has to pay? Medical bills, exactly. So that actually seems pretty straightforward, fine, but it's actually a little bit more complicated because it assumes something that maybe we should not assume, namely that it's okay to go to a doctor and that it's okay for the doctor to heal the victim. Why is that something that's not obvious? Any ideas? Why might you say, in the Jewish philosophical tradition, that it's actually not obvious that you are permitted to go to a doctor, or that the doctor is permitted to heal? Yes, Sarah.
It could feel like you're playing God. If God wanted the person to be sick,
excellent. God might have a reason for the person to fall ill. Maybe it's punishment. Maybe it's some other benefit that we just don't know about. And you are, as you said, playing God. Maybe the doctor is playing God. Okay? No matter how you feel about that, you can imagine that being a legitimate position that somebody takes in the Jewish philosophical tradition. If you turn to source number two, however, first of all, source number two, it's a Braita, so it's earlier material in the Talmud. It's a Tannaitic material. And we see that the following teaching was taught in the Academy of Rabbi Yishmael. Why are there two verbs? One is not really a verb, it's an infinitive absolute, but that's not important. Verapo yirapa, why do we have this redundancy in the Pasuk? Rabbi Yishmael says, from this seeming redundancy, you learn that permission was given to the doctor to heal. So, of course, it teaches us that the assailant has to pay for the victim's medical expenses. And number two, we learn that actually God has given doctors the permission to heal. Let's turn to number three. Let's see how this, again, it's a Tannaitic material. Let's see how this Braita ends up playing out in a later Talmudic material, in the Gemara. As Rav Acha said, is everybody with me? Does anybody need source sheets? You definitely need the source sheet. Okay, who goes in to have his blood let should say, may it be your will, O Lord my God, that this operation should serve as a healing for me and that you should heal me. That you should have been capitalized. For you are a faithful doctor and your healing is certain. For it is not the way of human beings to heal. The Hebrew is Lefi she'ein darkan shel bnei adam lerapot. So you could translate that in a couple of ways. Or human beings do not have the right to heal, but thus are they accustomed anyway. So first of all, something about bloodletting is that it actually was not that effective. It often did more harm than good. It was an ancient medical practice. It did provide some temporary relief, which might explain why people continue to do it. So what would you say? What's Rav Acha's attitude towards healing? What does he think about going to doctors and about doctors doing what they do?
Concession.
It's a concession, exactly. It's certainly not ideal. And not only is it a concession, we'll let it go, but actually you should say a bracha. This, by the way, it's in Masechet Brachot. You should say a bracha when you're going in to the blood letter, requesting assistance from God. You need to say this bracha because God is the one who does the healing. But now, in classic Talmudic fashion, Abaye declared, disagrees with Rav Acha, let not a man speak thus, for we have this teaching from Dei Rabbi Yishmael. It is written, this rapo yirapa, we have a redundancy. From this we learn that permission is given to the doctor to heal. So Abaye disagrees with Rav Acha, which in itself is noteworthy that there is a plurality of opinions, there is a plurality of attitudes towards medicine and towards healing within the Talmudic corpus. So far, that's where we're at. This is the situation in the Talmudic literature. Please interrupt me, by the way, if you have any questions. Last year, this really has stuck with me. I was giving a class, and at the very end, somebody came up to me and said, you were so enthusiastic, and I really enjoyed listening to you, but I did not understand the word you said. So my heart sunk. So if you do have a question, feel free to raise your hand. I know the hour is late, so we got to stay awake. Yeah, Michael.
Before you go, the last word of the source thing on, that's free.
Okay, we'll get to that. We'll get to that the next source. So let's turn to source number four, the Tosfot HaRush. So the Tosfot HaRush is a medieval commentator on the Talmud, so it's already 1,000 years after this, the previous two sources were written. And it's a Talmudic, it's a commentator on the Talmud, a medieval commentator on the Talmud. And what does he say? From here we learn that permission was given to a doctor to heal. He's citing our Braita. He's quoting a friend of his, Rabbi Yaakov of Orleans. I know this is not the French pronunciation of Orleans, raised a question on this. He raised the question, isn't it obvious that doctors can heal? So already we're going from a time where both Rav Acha and Abaye and Rabbi Yishmael in the Talmud do not think it's obvious that doctors can heal, that doctors have the permission to heal. They don't see that as a given. Already in the Middle Ages, at least in this world, we'll see it's a little bit more complicated, at least for these people, it's obvious, of course, a doctor can heal. And now he cites another source. Behold, it is written, you shall return it to him. V'hashivoto lo. Any guesses on what that's referring to? Give it your most shot guess. Yeah.
A lost object,
a lost animal, actually. However, in the Talmud, it says, this is the source, that if you see somebody who's either drowning or who's being mauled by a wild animal, you have to step in to save them. Why? What do you have to return to them? Their health, exactly, or their physical well-being. Actually, my husband was mauled by a rabid coyote last year, and I ran in the other direction, so I actually did not know this source at the time. Otherwise, of course, I would have gone right in. So we know that, we have this source already, and it is also written, and this is even more obvious, Lo ta'amod al dam re'acha, you shall not stand idly by the blood of your fellow. Of course, what does that imply? A doctor should heal. And he says, what's the reason? What is the meaning of this idea that doctors need permission to heal? So this, I didn't even think about this, but this is extraordinarily relevant today when it comes to insurance companies and controversy about that. What does Rav Yaakov of Orleans say? He answered that permission was given to heal for money because you might have thought that a doctor was obligated to do it for free. Kind of an amazing statement that already in the Middle Ages, they're thinking about compensation for doctors and this tension between whether doctors should, how much doctors should pay, should get paid for their services. So that's one possibility. And I also want to call your attention to the fact that he says, we're already using the language of obligation. We're already moving away from the idea of permission to heal. And it's already kind of becoming, the language is becoming that of obligation, not permission. Now the Tosfot HaRush quoted his friend, and now he's going to weigh in. He says, it seems to me that the doctor is obligated to heal sickness which comes from human causes. That's obvious. Why do you need permission? What kind of permission from God do we need? It is with regards to sickness that comes by itself. And if I didn't have this derivation from the pasuk of rapo yirapeh, if I didn't have that redundancy, I would have thought you can heal, you know, if somebody punches you and you have a black eye or a broken bone, that's fine. A doctor is obligated to heal that. When do I need permission? What kind of illness? Natural, exactly, and something that's internal. And actually, it's fascinating. If you look at source number 7, Ibn Ezra. So Ibn Ezra, it's especially fascinating because he was actually a scientist. He was one of the ones who popularized science, Spanish science. He came from Spain and moved to Latin Europe, to Rome, France, England. He died in England. He's the one who popularized science. He wrote scientific textbooks. It seems that even Christians studied his scientific textbooks. It's not our science, it was astrology, some astronomy. But he says that actually, when it's in his comment on Virapo Yirapé, he says, you are allowed, a doctor is allowed to heal external wounds, but internal wounds, you don't touch them. You leave them to God. Now, Ibn Ezra typically, that's too strong of a word, Ibn Ezra often goes against the rabbinic tradition. So it's not so surprising that he makes a radical statement like that, but still, he is part of the normative Jewish tradition, and he's actually weighing in and saying, if you have an internal sickness, a natural sickness, a doctor is not allowed to heal you. That's noteworthy. Any questions before we move on? Yeah, just give me your name and... Okay.
If the doctor, I noticed like the first one that you started with was if somebody hits somebody. So if the doctor actually causes damage to a patient, well then what, you know, when he's supposed to heal him, but he actually causes damage or he loses the patient, does that go to the first thing that you said that he's...
Okay, you are anticipating the Ramban. Nachmanides, we'll get there. It's not exactly, but that concern does come up, and we will get there. Anybody else? Okay, let's move on. Let me get to the right place in my notes. Okay, let's move to the Rambam, which is source 11. And what was the Rambam's profession? He was a doctor. He was a prominent doctor. So it's not that surprising that we see the Rambam. He's really the one who most, in the strongest terms, among the medieval thinkers, he's the one who really sets forth the idea that healing is an obligation. That it's not just about permission, it's an actual halachic obligation for doctors to heal. Remember in the Gemara, with the idea of the Hashevotolo, of returning somebody's lost health, they don't extend that to medicine. I should have said that. They don't extend that to medicine. They limit it to the idea of drowning or being mauled by a wild animal. If you see somebody who's in trouble, you should step in and save them. But they don't talk about it in the context of medicine. It's not surprising that the Rambam would. At that point, medicine had already developed a little bit more, and the Rambam is actually a physician. So let's just look at the bold. This is the Rambam's commentary on the Mishnah. So what he's commenting on is interesting, a little bit complicated, not entirely relevant. What does he say? He says, it is an obligation. Shechayav harofe min hadin, it is a dioraita obligation for the doctor to heal the sick of Israel. And he ties this in, he extends it from the cases of drowning or wild animals, he extends it to medicine. He takes the source of the Hashivot Tolo and extends it to healing, to physical, medical healing. Okay, and then if you look at source number 12, and this is, we can argue whether or not he's talking about medicine here, but I think it's a fair assumption that he would include medical healing here. Anyone who can save but does not save is over on lo ta'amod al dam re'acha. Same idea, that this is, that you cannot stand idly by when somebody is dying. It's interesting, by the way, any thoughts? He doesn't mention the derivation from that redundancy, from Yerapo Yerapé. He doesn't take the idea that doctors have an obligation to heal from that redundancy. I don't know why. Any thoughts on why he might not go that route? Yeah, what's your name?
I think Nissan Hershkowitz. I think that what he's doing.
Why just, you know, you said, why only to heal?
Yeah. You're saying that there's tension between this idea that you have to heal Israel versus lo ta'amod al dam re'echa feels a little bit more universal, even though, that's a great question. There is a lot of halachic literature and the Ram, that's a whole other class. It happens that I once wrote a paper about it. But the question of when do you heal a Gentile and when do you not heal a Gentile or save a Gentile is an enormously complex subject. Let me put it this way. It's not surprising that the Rambam would, in his written work, limit this to Israel. But there are other places where he would say you should heal or save a Gentile for various reasons. It's not the same reasons that you would heal somebody who is Jewish.
Within the ramifications of medical doctors.
Yes, okay. Fair point. Good. I would say, I think that for the Rambam, v'rapo y'rapeh is so technical. You're taking what he sees as the sacred obligation to heal, and you're deriving it from this extra word, and that it feels almost a little bit too trivial for the Rambam. That would be my guess as to why he prefers psukim, which are a bit more, which have more gravitas to them. Something like, you shall not stand idly by the blood of your fellow, or you shall return, I like what you said, him to himself. Okay, extending it from objects to something much, much more monumental. So it is noteworthy that the Rambam diverges from the rest of the rabbinic and Talmudic tradition when it comes to how he derives the idea that doctors are allowed to or have the obligation to heal. Let's turn to the Rambam.
No, yeah. Lord Talmud is a negative, your Buddha here is a positive.
Okay, so there are two. So there's the obligation to heal, and then there's the prohibition of not standing idly by, not letting somebody die on their watch. Let's say. Okay, good. Let's turn to the Ramban. So we'll start with the Torah to Adam, which is a work that the Ramban wrote on. It's actually the laws of mourning. Source 13. And the Ramban says, and it's something really amazing, and I think it speaks to what Leon was saying before. First he says, so he's reflecting on this idea of permission was given to the doctor to heal. And think about, as we read, where he moves away, he's really synthesizing prior traditions. Where is he continuous and where is he discontinuous? So first he says, lest the doctor say, why should I agonize over this? Lest I make a mistake and accidentally kill people. Therefore, the Torah gave him permission to heal. So I think that speaks to what you were saying, Leon, that he's really, what is this? What is this a form of? new halachic category, which did not exist until now. He says in Hebrew, aval hai reshut, reshut demitzvahu. What, it's like almost a contradiction in terms. It's a permission of obligation. Okay? That's another area where he really does something different with this idea of permission to heal. And then he says it's ubichlal pikuach nefeshu, it's in the category of saving a life. And we learn from this that every doctor who knows this wisdom and this trade is obligated to heal. Again, with the obligation, it's not really permission anymore. If he holds himself back, he is shedding blood. And it is part of the obligation of v'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. Love your fellow as you love yourself. Again, he's citing this idea of permission to heal, but really, which psukim is he attaching it to? What kinds of psukim? More positive, I would say even more than that.
Fundamental,
exactly. Thank you. It's not the rapo yirepe, some kind of technical, an extra word, I'll derive it from there. It's v'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. It's shedding blood, it's shofech damim, if you don't do it. It is the idea of pikuach nefesh. You're talking about the fundamental principles upon which Judaism stands, and that is what the Ramban predicates, the idea that doctors have this permission obligation to heal. Let's turn to the next, to the Ramban's Perush on Al HaTorah, his commentary on Vayikra. Source number 14. Yes.
Marilyn. I'm a little confused then. Why is there a role of a doctor if he needs permission? Which came first? Why a doctor then he needs permission to heal?
Okay. I think the answer to that is, if I'm understanding your question correctly, you almost feel in the earliest sources, in the Talmud, even in Tanakh, that medicine was just a given and people did it. People administered it and people sought out medicine. And you almost get the feeling that the rabbis, they're conceding to that. They don't have control over whether or not people go to doctors. They don't even have control over whether or not doctors heal. So it's like almost a rabbinic acknowledgement that what they can legislate is limited. People are going to go to doctors, and maybe de facto, the rabbis are going to say that the doctors need some kind of permission to heal, and they'll give it to the doctors. The rabbis will find a way to give it to the doctors. That's what I would say. Which came first? I think the medicine, the doctors, the medical establishment, again, it was not scientific the way that we think of medicine today. That came first, and I think the permission came afterwards.
So it was not a formalized, the doctor was not a formalized role in that sense, unless I'm not...
Look, I think it's difficult to talk about medicine in the ancient world monolithically. There were different stages. It depended on the region that you're talking about. It's complicated. It is complicated. Yeah. Yeah, Rachel.
I'm wondering if in such a medieval time, maybe there was like a fine line between someone who's a healer and more witchcraft and...
Absolutely.
Maybe they didn't really know.
Very important point. Yes. You know? Yes, absolutely. That what's magic and what's healing is a little bit blurry. You're absolutely right. Look at the Ramban, and I think you're right that probably explains some of the ambivalence towards medicine. You see, we have in the Cairo Geniza prescriptions that they found. The Cairo Geniza was like basically Shemot, like this whole, it's a treasure trove now, but back then it was not. They found prescriptions with prayers attached to them. But it's not so clear whether those were official, formal, sanctioned prayers or if they were more popular prayers. And I think you're right that some of the ambivalence comes from that. Okay, look at the Ramban on Vayikra and listen to what he says. He says when Israel is in perfect accord with God, they constitute a large number, their affairs are not conducted at all by the natural order of things, neither in connection with themselves, nor with reference to their land, neither collectively nor individually. For God blesses their bread, their water, removes sickness from their midst, so that they do not need a physician and do not have to observe any of the rules of medicine. Like Hashem says in the Torah, Ki ani Adonai Rofecha, I am the Lord who heals you. And at that point, they did not turn to physicians, but only to the prophets. Or at least if you were good, that's what you did. And if you did turn to the physicians, you were perhaps making a big mistake. Let's skip to the bold. And by the way, the Ramban does not only mention people at the time of the prophets in the Tanakh. He also talks about rabbis in the Talmud where there was no nevuah, and also even rabbis back then who did not seek out medical healing. So let's go, and here the Ramban explains in the second, where I bolded it next, here the Ramban explains this idea of the permission to heal. He says, he quotes the Gemara, since it is not, or the Brayta, since it is not the way of human beings to heal, sorry, it wasn't Gemara, but thus they are accustomed. That is to say, had they not accustomed themselves to take medicine, people would become sick according to the degree of punishment corresponding to their sin. What Sarah said before, that's how, when we lived in this utopian, idealistic, spiritual society, that was how things worked. If God needed to punish you, God made you fall ill, and what did that serve as? It was a warning, it was a punishment, but it was also a wake-up call. Wake up, do teshuvah, figure out what you did wrong, and return to God. That's some utopia. However, once people start accustom themselves to mendicaments, I don't know what the difference is between medicine and mendicaments. Once people accustom themselves to this, God has left them, turn the page, to natural happenings. So, what's the idea? The idea is that once we as individuals, but really we as a community, as a society, as human civilization, once we opt in to medicine and to the natural world, what does God do? What's God's response to our opting in?
Opting out.
God, that sounds a little bit negative. I would say God pulls back. God retracts. But yes, that's the idea. What was that? Be careful what you wish for, okay? And now, more than that, once we live in that kind of world, which is not the utopia, if we look at the third line from the top, they did not say that permission was given to the sick to be healed, but instead they stated that since the person who became sick comes to the physician to be healed, so this is a reflection of the person seeking out medical treatment instead of seeking out God, because he has accustomed himself to seeking medical help, the physician should not refrain from healing him. It's at this point, what I said before about that this is a covenantal model, if you opt into medicine, then the physician must heal you. And that's really, this is where the permission really shifts to a sense of obligation. The physician can't say, I don't want to heal this person, maybe he's afraid, like the medieval medical malpractice, he might die under my hand, or the physician can't say, it is God alone who is the healer of all flesh. Once people have accustomed themselves to seeking such help, the physician is obligated to deliver the best medical assistance he can. Any questions up until now? Yeah, Richard.
Does the Nachmani identify that period where he thinks society or Jewish society elected to opt in?
it sounds like he's thinking about something biblical when there's nevuah. But we know in the Tanakh that there are doctors. So it's unclear to me whether this he actually thinks this happened,
yeah.
That this existed, that this was kind of an instantiated utopia, or whether it's some like almost like messianic ideal, which never really existed, never was, never, you know, maybe will be, but, you know, very, very distant. Yeah, David.
Does this show two different kind of views of the nobility of medicine, of the doctor? So Rambam would say you're fulfilling almost a godly ethical role, and Rambam would say, you know, you shouldn't chase, you shouldn't run into becoming a doctor, but we need doctors because patients are going to come to you.
I didn't think of it like that, but yeah, I could see that. I'd have to think about that. That's interesting. Yeah, Sarah.
Is Rambam saying that the ideal is not to seek medical help?
He would be saying that in some, I think he would say agree to that in some utopia. But not in the world we actually live in. Okay.
This is happening in context of there. You said different regions, different religions, but comparing, let's say, Christianity, Islam, in their specific regions, specifically the Ramban, what was happening when he was affected or influenced by what was happening around him at that time?
Okay, great question. I'm not 100% sure. I mean, the Ramban is living in a Muslim context, I don't know if there's a significant... The Ramban lives later, and he's living in Christian Spain. But remember that Christian Spain had been Muslim Spain and was influenced by currents in the Islamic world. So I'm not sure what the difference is between the way that the Christians were practicing medicine and the way that the Muslims were practicing medicine. That's a great question, and I don't even know where to look for that answer, but maybe I'll get back to you.
Did Nachmanides practice medicine?
A bit, but not to the degree that the Rambam did. Yeah.
So maybe, jumping ahead of you, but to this point, everything we've spoken about has been from the perspective of the doctor, whether or not he or she should act, not act, say, not, et cetera, et cetera. Do any of the commentaries here tonight address the patient and whether the patient seeks help from God's world and from the doctors within God's world and not God himself, as opposed to, in other words, bypassing prayer and going right to the doctor? Is that an issue?
Okay, it is an issue. I would say the sources that I have, and I want to say this, and I'm want to also be careful about making a categorical statement about this. You hear the patient's voices, especially in the sources we'll get to. You hear the patients, but the sources are not directed at the patients. And I think, and I wonder if almost there's a psychological reason for that, that it's more, there's something... This is where I feel like I'm on shaky ground. There's almost something more compassionate about addressing this information to the doctors and not to the patients.
So, I mean, it's a poor comparison, but in Shemot, Yosef's in jail and he's punished because he seeks help of his fellow, and not waiting on or leaning on God's help. Maybe.
I would be careful with that analogy.
I'm just using that as
a... Yeah, I hear what you're saying. I would say, this is my answer for you. I think we would need another class about from the patient's perspective. But I don't have that material prepared. Okay. Let's turn. What I want to do is I want to go back to the Rambam. If you look at the laws of Bikur Cholim, and what I want to do using the Rambam as a stepping off point, I want to push the Ramban's paradigm one step further. Remember that for the Ramban, the way that I described the Ramban was as seeing medicine as operating as a covenantal model, where if you opt in, if we opt in, then doctors have the obligation to provide the best medical treatment possible in their powers. When we look at the laws of Bikur Cholim, I think that what we see is that there are different, that according to the halakha and according to the Jewish philosophical tradition, there are additional dimensions, there are moral dimensions of the healing process. And that entails additional obligations and additional moral commitments that we, not just physicians, that we all must undertake. So let's look at the Ramban. And like I said at the outset, what we're looking for are the three values of humility, empathy, and the dignity of the sick. Just want to check my time. Yikes, but we could start. Okay, what does the Rambam say about Bikur Cholim? Number one, it's a mitzvat aseh. Shel divrehem levaker cholim. It is a positive commandment to visit the sick. Skip to the, and then he gives a list of positive commandments like this. And he says that these are acts of kindness that are done with one's body. They have no shi'ur, they have no limit to them. And he says, even though they are technically rabbinic, and we could have a whole other discussion what the Rambam means when he says this, they are included under v'ahavta l'recha kamocha, love your fellow as yourself. These are all things that you would like others to do to you, and then if that's the case, you should do them for your fellow human being. Okay, turn the page and look what the Rambam says about visiting the sick. A few halachot later, he says, it's a commandment on everybody, al hakol, afilu gadol mevaker et hakatan. Even somebody who's great visits the lesser. Any ideas? Well, you know what, we're running out of time, so I'll just give it away. Where the Rambam might have gotten this idea from? Think about the greatest. Exactly, where God actually does Bikur Cholim for Avraham Avinu. Very good. That might be kind of where the Rambam is modeling himself. And then he says, and everyone who visits the sick, it is as though he took away part of the illness. This is a doctor speaking. He's saying that visiting the sick, it's not just visiting the sick, it's really ministering to the sick, is actually part of the healing process and made it easier on the sick person. And this is what's amazing. Whoever does not visit, it is as though he spilled blood. If you don't visit, think about what the Rambam said about the obligation of doctors to heal. He's saying something similar about people who do not visit the sick. It is as though they spilled blood. And I think that pasuk alone, the Rambam's use of that pasuk demonstrates that healing for the Rambam is much more than kind of physical healing. He's thinking about the psychological and emotional and spiritual dimensions of healing. Look at the next source, the Midrash. Thus you find with Chizkiyahu Melech Yudah, at the time that Chizkiyahu fell ill, God told Yeshayahu, go tell him, set your affairs in order, for you are dying and will not live. And Chizkiyahu said to Yeshayahu, Yeshayahu, customarily a man who goes to visit the sick says to him, from heaven should compassion be upon you. And a doctor who comes says to him, eat this thing, don't eat that thing, drink this, but don't drink that. What don't you say? Even the doctor, even if the doctor sees that the patient is near death, he does not say, set your affairs in order, for you are dying and will not live, because this might weaken the person's resolve. And you, and really, it's not just Yeshayahu who's telling him this, who's really telling him this? It's almost a critique of God, of how God is doing Bikur Cholim. You are telling me, set your affairs in order, for you are dying and will not live. I'm not sure how relevant this is to those of us who do Bikur Cholim. It certainly relevant to doctors. How do you talk to a patient who's dying? And that's, for me, watching my father go through his illness, that's something that the doctors who did it well, the doctors who didn't do it well, that can change the entire experience of sickness and of dying. And to me, the value of empathy, of how you talk to somebody, how you would want somebody to talk to you about this kind of issue, how you talk to a family, that value is very much expressed in this midrash and is part, again, part of the experience, part of the whole enterprise of healing. Finally, the last source, or really the second to last source, source number 17, which is also in the Gemara in Shabbat, says, Rabba Bar Barkana said, when we followed Rabbi Elazar to inquire after a sick person, to do Bikur Cholim, sometimes he would say to him in Hebrew, Hamakom Yivkadecha Leshalom, the omnipresent visits you in peace. And other times he would say this in Aramaic. But how could he do this? Did not Rabbi Yehuda say, you should never petition for your needs in Aramaic? And why not? Because when you petition for your needs in Aramaic, the angels cannot listen, they can't answer positively, because the angels do not understand Aramaic. Little known fact. And what's different about when you visit somebody who's sick? Why is it okay to use Aramaic when you're praying, when you visit somebody who's sick and praying on their behalf? Because the Shekhinah is with a person who's sick. And so therefore the Shekhinah presumably does understand Aramaic, and you can pray for that, for the sick person in Aramaic. Even more powerfully, and think about the situation of going to visit somebody who's sick. And actually the next source talks explicitly about this, about somebody who has diarrhea, somebody who might be hooked up to tubes, somebody who's not fully clothed, somebody who's actually not, you would not expect that the Shekhinah is with that person, and yet the Shekhinah itself is with the person to the degree that you can talk in Aramaic because the Shekhinah who is there understands. And if you turn the page, the continuation of this is, one who enters a house to visit the sick may sit neither upon the bed nor on a seat where the sick person is lying or sitting, but must wrap himself about and sit in front of him because the Shekhinah is actually above an invalid's pillow. The Gemara is almost envisioning this in physical terms, that the sick person has God or some manifestation of God upon them. And you can't, because of that, the sick person can be on the bed, of course, but you cannot sit down on the bed. And what I see from that is the dignity of the sick. That's how you have to treat somebody who's sick. Somebody who might seem visually, intuitively undignified, in the depths of indignity, the Gemara raises them to such a degree that they are more dignified, they have more transcendence than you have, than the visitor actually has. I want to go to the last source, and this comes with a very strong recommendation to read this book. It's called Being Mortal by Dr. Atul Gawande. I would say anybody who has a sick family member, a sick friend, a friend who has a sick family member, basically everybody should read this book. It's an incredible, incredible read. I would say it's a life-changing read. Let's read this last source together. Being mortal is about the struggle to cope with the constraints of our biology, with the limits set by genes and cells and flesh and bone. Medical science has given us remarkable power to push against these limits, and the potential value of this power was a central reason I became a doctor. But again and again, I have seen the damage we in medicine do when we fail to acknowledge that such power is finite and always will be. We've been wrong about what our job is in medicine. We think our job is to ensure health and survival, but really it is larger than that. It is to enable well-being. And well-being is about the reasons one wishes to be alive. Those reasons matter not just at the end of life or when debility comes, but all along the way. Whenever serious sickness or injury strikes and your body or mind breaks down, the vital questions are the same. What is your understanding of the situation and its potential outcomes? What are your fears and what are your hopes? What are the trade-offs you are willing to make and not willing to make? And what is the course of action that best serves this understanding? If to be human is to be limited, then the role of caring professions and institutions, from surgeons to nursing homes, ought to be aiding people in their struggle with those limits. Sometimes we can offer a cure, sometimes only a salve, sometimes not even that. But whatever we can offer, our interventions and the risks and sacrifices they entail are justified only if they serve the larger aims of a person's life. When we forget that, the suffering we, doctors, he's a world famous surgeon, the suffering we inflict can be barbaric. When we remember it, the good we do can be breathtaking. So I think what, when we read this, humility, dignity of the sick, and empathy. What I think that the Jewish sources add to Gawande's point is they broaden them. They broaden his point. From the Jewish point of view, when we include Bikur Cholim into this equation, we're not just talking about doctors and nurses and nursing homes and hospital administrators. We're talking about all of us. We're all part of the healing process. Okay, we're not all neurosurgeons, but we're all responsible for our fellow human beings, our friends, our family members' healing. And I think that's actually an amazing innovation that the laws of Bikur Cholim specifically that's a really tough one.
So in that saying, I think it's sort of consistent with what you're saying is the limitation on a human being who is a doctor to view himself as secondary or even just a facilitator of God's will is so difficult that perhaps it's really
to what is going on in the medical world, that doctors need permission in the sense that they need permission from the patient, they need permission from the family, they need to be cognizant of these kinds of values. It's not a one-man show. And I mean, this is, I think that it carries more credibility when it comes from somebody like Dr. Gawande, but yes, I see bringing it from, getting that perspective from those of us, from the regular folks, is important and maybe unnecessary. Yeah.
According to the idea where you said that there's an obligation now that the people have opted in,
mm-hmm.
can the patient, under that guise, can the patient abrogate the doctor's obligation? Can he?
Are you asking from a halachic point of view?
Well, we know the answer.
What do you mean? What do you give me a practical example?
Can he take away? Can he say, you know, you're not obligated anymore and allowed, you know?
Okay.
Way that.
I'm not sure about that. There's a great article by J. David Blythe, who writes a lot about this, where he compares the Jewish tradition, the Catholic tradition, and the American Anglo-Saxon legal tradition. I don't know. That's.
That's a lot of time.
How so?
Because if he's going to disobligate him, then he's going to allow him to die.
Uh-huh. So it's like a leaf nei iver almost.
Yeah.
Like, don't put a stop. Okay. Maybe.
But he's not one. Interesting.
Look, I think there are different, factors and different considerations that would go into that question. Yeah.
I want to ask a question.
Yeah.
I've seen times when doctors will tell a patient something encouraging. We have no way to quantify this, but it broke the person's spirits up, gave them strength, they continued on. But what if the doctor, referring to your source number 16, when the doctor had when, you know, because he tells the Navi about how many inside of the Bekehak he made out of them. Let's say a person does really have a terminal illness.
Yeah.
And the truth is, there's no way out. Is that considered a form of murder? The doctor tells him, you better take care of business. You know, say I'm a...
Right.
You know, call in the priest. You know,
right.
Whatever it is.
Right.
Is that considered...
That's a problem.
Call in the chaplain. Is that considered, you know, an hour value system, a form of murder? Is that... Or is that reality? When a person goes to the situation and says... I'm the doctor for 60 years. You're going to die.
Look, that's I could never speak to that. I would say that what the Midrash is really telling us is that there's a certain almost flippancy, which Yeshayahu, again, this is the Midrash, it's not in the Tanakh, but there's a certain flippancy, there's a certain kind of just patness to this.
That's a direct quote from the Tanakh.
Yes, so but I'm saying this, the rest of the exchange. But the rest of the exchange. So I would say that it depends. I mean, it's an enormously complex question. It depends on the situation. From my own individual experience with this, it depends on what signals the patient is sending out and what signals the family is sending out. And I think you're right that there are certain protocols that have to be followed. But it's something that should be undertaken with a tremendous amount of thought and consideration and sensitivity and real analysis of the situation. And I think what the Midrash is pointing out is that sometimes it's really not. It's said in an incredibly, not just blunt, but kind of thoughtless, like literally thoughtless way, coarse, exact, vulgar way, which doesn't account for that. I want to be sensitive to the time. I think I did an hour.
I'd like to thank Dr. Labaton for being here.